So thank you very much for having invited me. I always appreciate enormously to be here and to be in a totally international environment, which is of course absolutely necessary when we address issues like this one. So my intention is mainly based upon my own experience and observation to try to communicate, and I hope that what I will say is not necessarily said everywhere, is not necessarily what you have heard until now, particularly when I compare the non-conventional policies in Europe and in the rest of the world, including, of course, many in the United States of America. So my intention is to, after a little start introduction, to, I would say, explain a little bit how I understand what are the main reasons for the crisis we had to cope with, which was the worst crisis since World War II and probably potentially the worst crisis since World War I, had we not taken very bold and very, very swift measures, both in the constituency of central banks and in the constituency of governments. And after having elaborated a little bit on these major reasons, and also perhaps after having given you some reasons to continue to worry, because some of the global indicators we have, it seems to me today, are as bad as what we had before the 07 and 08 crisis. So there is no reason to be complacent in any respect on the present period. After that, I will embark on some remarks. It would be the second chapter, if I may, on unconventional policies. And I will try again to present unconventional policies in a way which is not necessarily the usual one. Then I will elaborate on something which I consider extremely important in the present state of the doctrine of the central banks. I call that conceptual convergence. I take the crisis as having helped, I would say, some kind of accord between most of the central banks in the advanced economy. Other speakers, other previous central bank, former central banks, or central bankers today, are not too keen on underlining and on stressing that we have converged enormously in the crisis. And in many respects, it seems to me that we were not ourselves in Europe immobile in this convergence. There was from time to time convergence on our own positions, in other dimensions, of course, convergence on dimensions of friends in the US or even in Japan. And then I will try to conclude with a number of remarks which might also be a little bit concentrating on Europe. After all, I am European. I have been president of the ECB, and I guess that you are interested by perhaps what's going on in Europe in the present period, in an environment which is, in terms of communication, quite adverse, obviously, when I read the articles here and there and the remarks which are made not only in the rest of the world, but also in Europe. So I said that we had to cope with the worst crisis ever since a century, potentially. And I said that we probably would have been in a situation which was abominable, worse perhaps than the 1930s of the 20th century period, had we not taken very, very bold and swift measures. It reminds me Einstein explaining that theory was when nothing was working in his own domain, but you knew why. And practice, that was everything was working well, but you didn't know why. And he was saying, in that particular case, it is a quotation of Albert Einstein, in that particular case, we admirably merge theory and practice. Nothing works and we don't understand why. And it was more or less the situation we had at the start of the crisis, even in 2007, but particularly, of course, after the collapse of Lehman Brothers in 2008. And we had a very rapid discussion on the situation of the central bankers, but of all economists at the time, because the models that we had were clearly not working. Not only that we are not working in terms of pre-announcing that we had an extremely vulnerable and dangerous situation, they were also not working in describing what was happening after the Lehman Brothers collapse. And to the extent that I said myself publicly at the time that we had the sentiment that we were abandoned by economic theory. And that I was relying myself in the ECB mainly on anecdotes given by CEOs, by I would say people that were in the real economy and were telling us what they saw. But all the projections that we had on all models that were available, not only at the ECB but also in the national central banks, were not appropriate, and we were permanently during three quarters out of the ranges that were suggested for the euro area economy by the modeling of the time. So very rapidly, because and I guess that you were indicated a number of papers, a lecture I gave some time ago, and also a paper of the G30 which I chaired until last month, and which I trust was interesting because you had there some kind of consensus amongst central bankers, even if we did not agree on everything, but we had a lot of elements where we were agreeing. So only as a matter of, as a reminder, if I may, we had clearly one of the reasons, and again, I'm not listing the reasons in considering that they are, I would say, the most important one and so forth, but we had a sophistication of financial markets. This is banal, everybody says that, which was extraordinarily rapid. The alliance of technology, of deregulation, of full liberalization of financial markets exploded more or less in the period up to the crisis, and the growth of derivatives, the growth of shadow banking, the sophistication of the financial instruments was one of the major causes. It was so complex that only a few people could decipher. Those people themselves were had no, I would say, overview of the overall situation, and it was again very difficult to decipher and very obscure. A second reason was that there was also permitted by technology, permitted by globalization, by the interconnection of all financial and non-financial institutions, by markets, by economies at national and international levels, and I would say strongly encouraged by all authorities, a level of interconnectedness that had never been seen before. And that level of interconnectedness between, again, all markets, all institutions, of course financial institutions first, but also all the real economy institution of a certain dimension, created a level I would say fostered a level of rapidity of contagion that was absolutely unseen. And I will go back to this in terms of challenges for authorities, central banks and governments. A third point, which might be the most important one, was that particularly during the period going from 95 to the crisis, we had an incredible excess and generalize of leverage, public and private. In the advanced economy in particular, not, and I will go back to that, not in the emerging economies, but in the advanced economies, we could see an incredible excess of leverage. So this was, of course, something which everybody knew was dangerous. But, and I will go back to that, we were in a period of benign neglect. We were in a period where that phenomenon, because we had quite a reassuring level of inflation, because we had the sentiment that the stability of inflation and stability of output, we were very proud, and I'm not speaking particularly in DCB, but at a global level, and economists, more the mainstream of the economists, were extremely proud to say we have a low volatility of inflation and a low volatility of the output of the real economy. So it's fantastic. It is a moderation in terms of volatility that we were aiming at. We have an appropriate level of inflation. So the low volatility adds to the good judgment we have on the situation from that standpoint. And we have also a good level of growth, so growth without with price stability over the long run, without again a high level of volatility, is very good. And as I said in the paper, but I said that in real time, and that's the reason why some economists here are happy with what we said at the time. We've forgotten the Minsky hypothesis clearly. And I have to say, if I want to be fair and just, that the BIS, the Bank for International Settlements, was extremely clear, and the chief economist in particular of the BIS, in mentioning this, I would say, benign neglect that appeared to be dramatically benign. And so all the, I would say, previous work that had been done by Irving Fisher, by Hyman Minsky, on the dangers of having an accumulation of debt outstanding, both public and private, was very much forgotten. Only to tell you the following, because it might be interesting for you to be aware of that. The global outstanding debt represented in 2000 Q4 250% of global GDP. In 2007 Q4 274%, so percentage of GDP. And global GDP was galloping, it was very good. So it's an augmentation of 24% of the global GDP during quite a short period of time, you see. It's really, really impressive. And you will tell me now the lessons is understood. That is a cause for drama, and of course we are very cautious now. But what happened from 2007 to 2015, Q2, so Q4 2007, Q2 2015, is that we are now at 299%, not now, in 15, and it continues to go on, plus 25% of the GDP. I consider, and we publish a paper which is quite interesting, I made publicity for the G30 papers, on shadow banking. And these figures are in this paper, with the indication, if there is a global indicator that could be considered as reasonably reliable as regards the dangers in terms of future crisis, then let's look at that. We did not change the course of the global increase of the outstanding debt outstanding in terms of GDP, global GDP. What is very interesting, and of course it makes all the change since the crisis, from 2000 to 2007, we had 79% of the augmentation of debt outstanding that was concentrating on the advanced economy, and only 21 on the emerging economies. I am thinking particularly of the Brazilian team here. And from 07 to 15, we have now 50-50. The emerging economy jumped, in terms of participation in the augmentation of debt outstanding from 21% to 47%, and the advanced economy, and it is part, of course, of the hard lesson for them, went down from 79 to 53. So that was my third cause, reason for the crisis. I already mentioned the great moderation, which is certainly another reason. I have to say that it is absolutely strange that there was such a consensus amongst economists to think that we had found out in the advanced economy mainly and at the level of the global economy the right way to have growth without inflation forever. One of the reasons, I have to say, in terms of monetary policy concept and fundamentals, was that there was a curious idea according to which it was not appropriate to look at the monetary aggregates, to look at the components of the monetary aggregates, to look at the counterparts of the monetary aggregates. In particular, the fact precisely that the credit dynamics were galloping, credit is one of the counterparts of the monetary aggregates, was not important, again, as long as you had an analysis which was projecting price stability over the short, medium, and long run. Not short, but say medium and long run. And that of course, were putting the ECB and the continental European tradition in a difficult situation because, as know perhaps the German citizens here, we were considered very rear guard with the idea, bizarre idea, that we were looking at the evolution of the monetary again in a sophisticated manner, with attention given to the counterparts of the monetary aggregates. But again, it was not the global understanding of what was important. And of course, it added intellectually an enormous amount of credibility to the benign neglect, great moderation period. And the fact that we were more or less under a concept which was relatively short, medium term, say, which was generalizing at the global level, not in the US and certainly not in continental Europe, not in the ECB, but was the, I would say, inflation targeting, with the first concept of understanding inflation targeting, which was quite a short-term targeting, so 2 years or 18 months, 2 years, with the idea that the central bank had to guide the missile in order to reach the 2% in a 2 years period, say, to oversimplify, without taking too much account of the inflation dangers over time with the accumulation and the piling up of debt and possibly of the deflation threats if there was any kind of bubble explosion. And the last point I would mention, but which is very much linked to the great moderation and to this tranquility, which was the pre-crisis state of mind, of course, would be the fact that there was a very profound belief in the efficiency of markets in almost all circumstances, with the sentiment that we were permanently, because of the market efficiency, close to an appropriate equilibrium. The idea that you could have multiple equilibria, which is now, of course, generalized, fortunately, in the, I would say, vision of the mainstream economist, but that idea was not dominating at all. And the idea was we are permanently, for very solid theoretical reason, close to the appropriate and appropriate equilibrium. And then, of course, if you had this sentiment on the efficiency of financial market, you and markets in general, you would be in a very, very I would say, blinded state of mind. I listed a number of reasons. There are reasons that you could perhaps consider okay, because it's difficult to foresee the fantastic structural changes that we had in the global economy and the global finance. So I would say the two first reasons I gave, sophistication of all financial instruments, interconnectedness and so forth, I can accept fully that we could have had a difficulty to understand what was the emerging new property of such a world. It is much less forgivable, of course, to have the three last reasons, because the increase of leverage, we should have known that it was very dangerous, and I already said that. The great moderation and so forth, the benign neglect generalized, was something also that is not forgivable, not easily forgivable, if I may. And of course, the efficiency of markets was one theory, but again, normally we should have had a debate on that. And again, I am obliged to say that as far as we were concerned, the idea that the dynamic of credit was going very fast was something that we were capturing ourselves. I don't pretend that we had a monetary policy which was exemplary. And unfortunately, we were, of course, plunged in the crisis. But to our credit, you can put that we were the only one accepting to be bashed permanently, which was not very agreeable in all the colloquium, because again we were strangely rear backward looking, and looking in particular at the overall dangers of piling up debt outstanding. So I don't elaborate more on that, but if I had to give two names that I would, and I remember several times having mentioned that, you know, at the before the crisis and in the crisis, it was Minsky on the one hand and Knight on the other hand. The I would say Knightian uncertainty, that kind of uncertainty that you cannot probabilize, because it is of a different nature of the risk that you can probabilize. So a very high level of quality of uncertainty, if I may, which we could experience in the crisis. So let me finish with this first small chapter. And again, you have in the papers that have been circulated some stuff, additional stuff. Now, remarks on unconventional monetary policies. I see three dimensions of the objectives of unconventional policies. I see one first, obviously, in terms of chronology, we introduced unconventional measures, both in the US and in Europe, fighting against a grave and immediate threat of collapse of the financial system. So that was exactly what happened after Lehman Brothers, but it started before. I had myself to cope with in August 9, 2007, a total dislocation of the money market in Europe, associated with a phenomenon which were triggered by the subprime crisis in the US, but the Europeans were extremely, I would say, unfortunately, in risk on the subprime because they had invested enormously in this kind of instrument. And the entire world was in risk in the subprime. So at a moment where we had a number of signals that were extremely bad in the US, in Europe, in the rest of the world, there was that day an immense demand for euros in order to swap these euros vis-à-vis US dollars. And the first measure that was not taken in Japan, because Japan had a crisis long before and had tried a lot of unconventional measures before. But the first unconventional measures which was taken in the other part of the world, US and Europe, was the illimited supply of liquidity that we decided at that time. And we were asked 95 billion euros, which is something which was totally enormous, more than $100 billion, seen by the rest of the world as something which was totally shocking. But to the extent that we had our own money market that was totally collapsing, we had no more any money market, we decided at the level of interest rates, which was the level at the time, in my memory, something like 4%, we decided to give all the liquidity that was asked by the commercial banks. And we regained control of the situation over time, but it was quite a shock. Then we regained appropriate control, and we had the 15th of September 2008, the collapse of Lehman Brothers. And again, on both sides of the Atlantic, we embarked on highly unconventional measures. It is important to see that they were not the same. In Europe, because the commercial banks are absolutely decisive, the financing of the European economy is based at the level of perhaps 75%, or was based at the time. It is changing progressively, but 75-80% of the financing of the European economy was coming from the commercial banks, and 20% from the market. So our main problem, in a time where we had a grave and immediate threat of collapse of the financing of our economy and of collapse of the financial system, mainly commercial banks, the appropriate idea to be sure that the liquidity would be there was to tell all banks you will have unlimited access to liquidity. In the United States of America, the situation is exactly the reverse. Market 75, banks 25. And so the grave and immediate threat of collapse of the system meant in the US no more financing of the economy through markets. Another reason why the central bank of the US, instead of concentrating on banks, concentrated on markets and gave liquidity to markets at the moment where the main problem was, again, this grave and immediate threat of systemic crisis. So that is the first element that I wanted to mention, the first dimension of the non-conventional measures. We had to invent that in real time. The only, example we had was, of course, the Japanese and what they did before, long before, by the way. A second dimension of the objectives of unconventional policies would be making appropriate delivering appropriate substitution by the central bank, through the central bank, to a private sector intermediation which does not function at all or function very poorly. And again, one can understand that for the Central Bank of Europe, substituting to an intermediation on the money market which was not functioning meant giving all the liquidity they wanted to all participants, namely commercial banks. In the US, again, it was giving all the liquidity they could through purchases of tradable securities, in direct intervention on the market, taking into account again the way the two economies were structured. And there is a third element, which is today probably presented to you, as the most important goal, because of course things have moved over time, and because it is, a presentation which is very common, which is extra monetary accommodation needed when you have at the zero lower bound. So you have interest rates that are at zero level, or very, very low, equivalent to zero, and you have to intervene to try to cope with this abnormal situation to the extent that you consider that the equilibrium rate is itself negative, or that you have to take into account a situation from the macro standpoint, which is extremely demanding, and you have to, contribute through monetary policy as much as possible. And there, of course, you might distinguish two channels that would function with this idea. You can have a goal which would be lowering the medium and long term yield curve, so the benchmark yield curve, say the treasuries, which is one, or you want to reduce to as much as possible the spreads between the very high quality bonds or investments, any kind of instrument, and the lower quality instruments. And in both cases, you can attain that goal in intervening more or less massively on the treasuries in particular, because then you are doing both, if I may. If you intervene, if you purchase for real treasuries, you have both the lowering of the yield curve, the benchmark yield curve, and you are making room for the private sector being chased out of the high quality portfolio to concentrate on the lower quality portfolio. This is the I would say, the balance sheet of the central bank channel. So you see three, in my own understanding, three channels. Now, what were the instruments utilized? Then I will probably surprise you a little bit, because there is one instrument I will mention that is practically never mentioned. As I already said, we can utilize the unlimited supply of liquidity to commercial banks. That goes well with objective one and objective two. Substitution to a private sector intermediation doesn't function. Fight against grave and immediate threat of systemic collapse. You can do, as was done in the US and in Europe also, purchases of tradable securities. It can fit with objective one. It was done in the US at the very beginning, at a time where the interest rates were still quite high. It was fighting against the crisis. And of course, it also, as I already said, is good for two, for two. And it was something which was utilized quite heavily. Now, in the case of Europe, and I will go back to that, as you remember, we intervened selectively on the treasuries that had major problems, which is totally different, of course, for very good reasons from the United States of America. But I would mention also that the purchases of tradable securities, as already mentioned, goes well with 3-1, if I may, goal 3, lowering of the benchmark of the yield curve, and 3-2, lowering of the spreads. So in one case, you could say lowering the term premium on the best quality signature, lowering the spreads between lower quality and good quality. Now you have a third instrument which was utilized practically only in Europe, which was the off-balance sheet commitments. And they are quite powerful. Of course, part of the off-balance sheet commitments is the promise to give unlimited supply of liquidity, whatever happens. And that means that today, the European Central Bank is telling, I would say, the market and all participants in the market, if by chance, if unfortunately we had a new crisis immediately, we are committed to give 1 trillion more, 2 trillion more, 3 trillion more, because the eligible collateral that is in the balance sheets of the commercial banks is a multiple, a very, very important multiple of what they have presently, they are presently requesting from the central bank. And of course, the OMT, which was decided and was never utilized, is a typical, very powerful instrument which is a promise off balance sheet and has never been applied, but had a very, very strong impact, as you know, on those particular treasuries that were potentially vulnerable and could, and the market could consider that they could activate, of course, provided certain conditions would be met, this OMT, which came after the SMP interventions that was in particular done in my time and were heavily criticized, I have to say, in my time. Then you have another element which is also important, which is the forward guidance. So that the idea that you are committing in advance more or less whatever happens, and that of course can be discussed and criticized, but you try to anchor expectations as regards interest rates, both I would say as regards the interest rates decided in the realm of conventional monetary policy, but also the utilization of the non-conventional instruments. As you know, the ECB presently is saying we will maintain interest rates at their present level or lower for a considerable period of time. They added more or less as long as we will have the utilization of a QE. So it is a very, very strong long-term commitment. So now I mentioned the three dimensions of the objectives of the unconventional policies. I mentioned the instruments that I see that are part of this non-conventional policies. Of course, I did not mention the conventional policy itself, which is very well known. And let me only mention some specificities on Europe versus United States of America on top of what I already said, that you must always have in mind, because most of the commentators, it seems to me, particularly in the market literature, do not mention that we are in two different universes because of the structure of the financing of the economy. And to the extent that there is, I can say, a certain domination of the Anglo-Saxon economists in terms of mass, of critical mass, this you know, specificity of the US in comparison with Europe is very often forgotten, it seems to me. But there are a number of issues that are of course associated with the, not with the structure of the of both economies, but with the very nature of the euro area, where you have several economies. And I have to say that from the standpoint of the monetary policy, it is something which is which has not been, you know, studied to my knowledge. Maybe I'm wrong, maybe the professors that are here present will correct me. But the idea that, for instance, today, we have to get back to 2% as an average. Okay. And you communicate on that, the price stability, and I will go back to that, in Europe is not attained because we are not at the level of what we are telling our own people and all economic agents, price stability, namely less than 2, but close to 2. But we have a number of countries. These countries have different positions as regards their own competitiveness. Some are very highly competitive, have full employment, and have an enormous amount of current account surplus. For those countries, clearly, going above 2% would be normal. And you have countries that have lost competitiveness, have mass unemployment, and more or less deficit of the current account or a mediocre current account. For those countries, the objective is to regain competitiveness in the medium and long run. So the real message which is coming and should come, not necessarily from the ECB, but certainly from the Commission, should be you can go over and above 2%, namely Germany. I'm oversimplifying. But because you have other countries that are in that case. You, Italy, France, you should not do that because you have vast unemployment and you have to regain competitiveness. Do like Germany, do what Germany did at the beginning of the euro, regaining competitiveness with an national inflation lower than the average, which permitted precisely to regain the lost competitiveness at the time of the reunifications. So you see, one has to adjust. And I think it's a very important message I would give you. Beware of, I would say, simple recommendation given at the level of Europe as a whole or given at the level of the world as a whole. The recommendation for the US is not the same as the recommendation for Germany, say, or the recommendation for Canada or from Japan, for Japan. And there is a very, very, I would say, profound tendency to simplify communication, and particularly in Europe, where it is a big, big, big mistake. For instance, at the present moment, it's absolutely clear that the, say, Netherlands, Germany, in a certain dimension, Austria, have a situation which is a situation of good competitiveness, and they have an extremely accommodating monetary policy, obviously, because they have a very low level of spreads vis-à-vis the benchmark, the universal benchmark in the euro area. So all what you do at the level of the ECB doesn't change their own monetary policy. It remains extraordinarily accommodating. And so you have to accept that at a certain moment the monetary policy is at its absolute limit, and that other channels have to operate that are more or less in the hands, of course, of government structural reforms, appropriate fiscal policies, and certainly recommendation coming from the Commission. A word also on something which I think is interesting, and I mentioned in one of the papers, which is what I call myself the separation principle between the interest rates level and the use of the interest rate instruments, say conventional instruments, and the non-conventional monetary policy measures. That is something which I trust would be important. Not to confuse the two, to try to have a separate handling of the two. For objective one, it was obvious, and the proof of the matter is that we embarked on unconventional measures when the interest rates were not at zero at all. They were at a level which was not negligible. For objective two, substituting to the private sector when the intermediation does not function well, equally, we did that on both sides of the Atlantic at a moment where the interest rates were not at zero. When the third goal, extra monetary accommodation, when you are more or less at a very low level or at the zero lower bound, I would say clearly, when you are aiming at lowering the yield benchmark as much as possible, there is no separation principle. There is no separation. You're doing the same. But when you are aiming at diminishing as much as possible the spreads between the best quality investment signature and so forth and the lower quality signature, it can be independent of the level of interest rates. And I see a lot of merits for the central banks to be able, to manipulate both instruments more independently than perhaps the market is understanding. You had a very good example of that with the taper tantrum of the United States in 2013, when Ben said we will start the tapering, and immediately it triggered an explosion of interest rates. But in the mind of the Fed, it was not designed to do that at all. They had the idea that they could maintain the, I would say, interest rates at the low level that they had and not trigger an interest rate increase. It was a very, very big shock. It was a crash in the bond market, which was not anticipated at all. And in my opinion, one of the reasons why we had this problem was the market had totally assimilated conventional and non-conventional measures, and perhaps the central banks were not aware of the fact that they were letting the market creating their own artifact. Taper tantrum is a very good example. I don't suggest it's easy to get out of that trap, but look, the interest rates in the U.S. will go now up and up and up. As you might know, the level of balance sheet handling by the Fed of the tradable securities that they purchased before is maintained at the level of approximately $4 trillion. So they reinvest the maturities that are falling due, with the idea that it is still necessary to have this appropriate portfolio channel functioning, I would say, full speed, even if it does not augment. The $4 trillion are there, and the $4 trillion are influencing, of course, the portfolio allocation of the entire US economy and world economy. So you see, you can increase interest rates whilst you still are relying upon a very powerful portfolio channel through the through the balance sheet of your central bank. So I draw your attention to the fact that this is important. This is important. This is not, in my opinion, totally elucidated by academia, and it is worth mentioning. Last point: unintended consequences of ultra-accommodating policies. I don't insist too much. Time is elapsing. Clearly, there we have, of course, to the extent that we all embarked on unexpected ex ante and very powerful, obviously, monetary policy, accommodating in many dimensions, we have to beware of the unintended consequences that are new potential bubbles, new potential leveraging of segment of the finance and of the economy, a high level of risk taking, which is of course one of the goals that we are pursuing. You have the redistribution effects and the criticism, which is not that violent, but that you are enriching markets, that you are enriching the stock owners and shareholders, and that is incorrect. The central banks have no difficulty to respond until now to this criticism in saying, okay, you would prefer a crisis of the type of 29-30, okay, but look at the consequences on the poor people, on the most vulnerable segment of society. So the criticism is founded and has to be examined permanently, and of course the assets and liabilities associated with the non-conventional measures should always be looked at very, very carefully. But again, I don't think that the argument had a lot of clout until now. And certainly as long as we have mass unemployment in many economies. When you are at full employment, which is not necessarily the case in the US, even if apparently the figures are good, things will be different. And then you will have, I expect, a strong criticism coming from large part of the society to consider that it goes too far. And it goes too far both, I would say, in enriching some and in creating abnormal, artificial equilibrium. Now, the main unintended consequences of ultra-accommodating policy is very well known. The central banks have demonstrated that they had enormous power. They have demonstrated that they could take very bold measures, and they might be considered as doing all the job of the governments, of the parliaments, and of the other, partners, including the private partners. And that is something which is extremely serious, and we have to be fully aware of that. Very, very serious. I think it's a strong criticism. To the credit of the central banks, I have to say that they are all, and I did that in my time, been very, very blunt with the governments and all the other partners in telling them we cannot create ourselves prosperity. We can pave the condition, pave the way for appropriate stability, fighting against this threat of collapse of the real economy as well as the finance. But it is up to you to do the structural reforms. It is up to you to do the appropriate fiscal measures that are necessary not to recreate, this low level of growth and of real growth. Obviously, neither in the US, nor in Europe, nor in Japan, we can be satisfied with what he's doing, what he's done, what he's presently done. You know, the famous third row of Japan is not put in action. Many countries in Europe are taking advantage of the low level of rates and the fact that their finances are very easily handled. They don't realize that it is, of course, provisional, that it's transitory, that it will not last forever, and that they will have to pay a very high price themselves and their people for not doing the job, which is politically difficult, but it is absolutely necessary. And of course, some are doing the job, and they will take an immense advantage of the fact that, the particularly in those countries that have already been struck by the crisis, not to do all what is necessary to regain creditworthiness in a world which remains extremely unstable and demanding will be paid again with a very high price. So now let me turn to the last point, but I will go very rapidly, and perhaps we will have the appropriate exposition of you two, if I understand well. And then perhaps I will have to respond to questions. So I will be extraordinarily rapidly, because otherwise I will take your time. Conceptual convergence. I already mentioned that. It is something which strikes me as quite impressive, because it was not something which was decided by any international authority, any consultation amongst central banks in the advanced economy, any kind of meditation, including in Basel. I chaired a number of meetings, of the global economy meeting with all the central banks of the world, or with the GHOS, the governors and heads of supervision meeting, and so forth. But de facto, there has been a convergence, which is not only a convergence of the central bank's understanding of the situation and what was necessary to do, but also an understanding of the societies themselves, a convergence of doctrine and position as regards a number of points, which are, again, not only central bank's point, but also governments or organization of our society standpoint. I list the six, and I will take the definition of price stability as the last one, because I think it's the most striking, the most perhaps important, also a very important convergence in terms of future functioning of the global economy and global finance. But let me mention the six. The concept of communication has converged considerably in the crisis. The best place for locating banking surveillance has converged formidably under the crisis. The monetary policy concept has converged. I wouldn't say that we all have now the same monetary policy concept, but we are much closer. I could mention also, of course, the fact that we have converged on unconventional monetary policy, even if the instruments are not exactly the same, and that we have converged also as part of this non-conventional measures on the concept of forward guidance, even if we were very divided at the very beginning. So very rapidly, and only to open up the way for question. Communication. We were the first central bank to have press conferences, global press conferences, immediately after the meeting of the Governing Council. The Bank of England had no such conference, Bank of Japan no such conference, and the United States Fed had no such conference. In the crisis, it appeared that it was necessary to be, as I would say, close to the market and to the people, as was appropriate, and waiting for the publication of the minutes after 15 days or something appeared to be absolutely useless, because a lot of artifacts had been created during the time by the market itself, and a lot of stories and narratives that were not exactly what the central bank would have wished. You will tell me, why were you the only, at the beginning of the crisis, the only central bank to practice that? Very simple. We had many countries, many governors of central banks, and had we not communicated on the basis of a single narrative immediately after the decision, you would have had a multiple narrative coming from multiple speakers, translated, all translated in English, of course, that would have been total cacophony. So since the very beginning of the ECB, the idea that the president had to speak with his voice, which would be the narrative of reference for the central bank, immediately after, of course, the decision was taken, and on the basis of a paper which had been approved by the governing council, and on the basis of questions to explain exactly the situation. It works, I have to say, all taken into account quite well. It was this model that was considered appropriate to make communication converging. I could elaborate much more on communication, of course, and in a way we also converged towards the other central banks by publication of our own minutes, which was not in the tradition of the central bank. Best place for locating banking surveillance. As you might remember, we were totally divided before the crisis. You had two schools, one school saying banking surveillance must be very close to the central banks, and the other schools were saying banking surveillance should be as far away as possible from the central banks. UK was a case in point with the FSA and the idea that the central bank should not be involved in banking surveillance. And Germany was in between, a number of other countries, and the US too, and a number of other countries were in favor of having, I would say, the banking surveillance located very close or in the central bank. Now, apart from Japan, all central banks in the world consider that this is a major responsibility of the central bank. In Europe, it was a major structural reform to give the central bank the ultimate chapeau, if I may, on this banking surveillance. And in the UK, there has been a 180 a U-turn to get back to the central bank when it was decided before to put the FSA out of the central bank. This is very, very important because, again, we were divided, profoundly divided, with two big schools, and now we are very much united. Close to that is the convergence towards the idea that macroprudentials should be very close to the central bank, that preventing systemic financial instability should be very close to the central bank, with new institutions created on both sides of the Atlantic and in Japan. So that is something which I take it is very, very important. In terms of monetary policy itself, nobody now is claiming that a central bank should not look at credit dynamics. The enrichment of the monetary policy concept has been very, very important, generalized, and of course, it is rewarding for those who thought that it was better to look at it. But now, of course, the drama of the crisis makes the demonstration easy, which does not mean that it is easy to have the appropriate monetary policy concept to explain how you merge your two analyses, the, I would say, real economy analysis, the economic analysis on the one hand, and the monetary analysis on the other hand. But the idea that if you let the credit dynamics, either, of course, being much too miserable or too gallop too rapidly, then you're paving the way necessarily when time comes, either for inflation threats that could be extremely dangerous for the stability of prices, which is your franchise, or deflation threat, and as we could experience in many economies in the recent period. So that is very, very important too. And I don't elaborate more on the unconventional monetary policy and forward guidance and so on. Now, last point, and I would perhaps not conclude on that because I have two or three other remarks, but certainly insist on that. We were totally divided as regards the goal of a central bank. You had a number of central banks that were pursuing the idea that they would deliver price stability. So the Fed was not mentioning what price stability meant, clear enough. And they were keeping all their power dry in order to do whatever they thought was appropriate without being trapped in a precise definition of what was price stability. Which was, of course, something of a drawback in times where you had a high level of instability, a high level of volatility after a long period of calm and great moderation, because then the market participants had nothing to anchor their expectations. They didn't know what was the ultimate goal in the medium and long term of the central bank, and they were not given any guidance in this respect. But it was the case in the US. Same in Japan. And I'm concentrating, as you see, on major, central banks in the major economies. In Japan is number two. US is number one. Japan is number two. So that counts. And you had two in the major, in the central banks that are issuing currencies that are in the basket of the SDR, of the special drawing rights. You had the ECB saying since the very beginning what we call price stability is less than two but close to two, with an important clarification in 2003. But the market never missed the point. Since the very beginning, the anchoring of our inflation expectations medium long term was around, say, 1.7, 1.8, 1.9. So there was no real misunderstanding with the market, but we thought it was better to solidly say, but close to 2. And in the UK, they started with 2.5, and then they went down to 2 to be, at the time, closer to us. At the moment I'm speaking, all major central banks in the crisis decided to converge to 2%. So now the US Fed said, we consider that the appropriate level of price stability is 2% in the medium run. Japan said 2% in the medium run. And of course, the other central banks, namely Bank of England and the ECB, maintain their own position. So at the moment I'm speaking, put China aside. There might be a Chinese citizen here. No? No? should be. now the one is going in the basket of the, is in the basket of the SDR, but and we will see what happens exactly. But the previous basket was made of four currencies. The four currencies have the same definition of price stability. And I really take it, I draw your attention to that. It is because we went through a period of extreme volatility, of extreme unanchoring of any all expectations, of major difficulty that we had to, observe. Because again, it was a spontaneous, quote unquote, decision in the US. A very courageous one, by the way, because it was not obvious that Ben Bernanke would obtain a majority to do that. It was not obvious at all because he could have had also drawback of the kind, but who are you to decide that, which is very, very important. After all, your independence is associated with the law, so we can change the law. We the Congress can change the law. And why not deciding in the Congress what is the appropriate, like in the UK, what is the appropriate level? Because I forgot to mention that in the UK, the ultimate decision making is relying upon the government and not the central bank. And of course, you have also the level of unemployment. If you trust or not in the computation of unemployment in the US, but the Congress should have said, that's okay, but we need 3.5 or 4% goal for unemployment. And then, you see, it was very bold, not easy, but the idea that we were in a world which was so shaky, so dangerous, and that a number of operators, market participants, investors and savers, and the real economy was missing the, I would say, capacity to solidly anchor expectations that this decision was taken. So, I take it that it is currently under assess. I am a little bit disappointed because I thought that what I was saying was very important. I said that since years. It is not considered until now by the mainstream as something as important as I feel it is. Now, I said that perhaps I had two or three words in conclusion. I didn't say a word on secular stagnation. We can address the issue of secular stagnation and why perhaps equilibrium interest rates are so low for long. What happens exactly in terms of TFP, total factor productivity, in our economies and so forth? This is important. And all the, I would say, dialectics of the meditation on, is it true that at certain moment we had equilibrium rate that were negative in the advanced economy? The independence of the central bank is extremely important. And again, I draw your attention to the fact that we could say a lot on that. You might have seen that one of the major conclusion of this work by the G30 is, of course, that the independence of the central bank is very solid. And let me only mention one point which is striking. Independence of central banks was, until the crisis, considered as necessary to permit the central bank not to be dictated their behavior, say a laxist behavior or too accommodating behavior, by executive branches. And the political sphere would have a permanent tendency, which is true, obviously, to call for, I would say, very accommodating behavior, laxist behavior. Bon. Reasoning short-term and not long-term. In the crisis, and I would say in the US as well as in Europe, the central banks took decisions that were so bold and so swift, as I already said, that not only they would not have been taken by the political sphere, but on the contrary, they would have been criticized heavily by the political sphere. The example of the US is very good, because when they embark on the TARP program, the Congress refused to vote the TARP program, which was the equivalent on the side of the Treasury and of the executive branch of what the central bank had already been doing. So, if you had said it is the Congress who has to decide upon what the central bank will do, the independent central bank will do in terms of very dramatically demanding time, then we would have had a dramatic crisis, because it would have taken not one half day or 2 days, but a fortnight. And in a fortnight, you would have been in a dramatic situation. So I draw your attention to this, I would say, paradoxical aspect of the independence of central bank, which is, of course, an additional argument for having these institutions that are able to take, independently of the political sphere, decisions that could be either more, I would say, reasonable or more wiser, or perhaps bolder. I have a large number of other points. The only one, and I will conclude on that, I promise that I would say a word of Europe and of the euro. You have to know, European and not European, that the support to the euro in the euro area, at the moment I am speaking, is at the highest level that has been registered since the setting up of the euro. Nobody says that, but it is in the last Eurobarometer. 70% of the population of the euro area is backing the sentence, do you agree or not with the sentence, an economic and monetary union with a single currency, the euro? 70%. It is the level of 04, 07, 08, periods where I was myself president, but which were immediately before the drama of Lehman Brothers. It is not at all what you read. You read that the euro is about to vanish, the euro area about to be dismantled, and so forth. It is not what our people are thinking today. And I draw your attention to the fact that in Germany it is 81%. 81%. When very often you're reading the German prefer the DM and so forth. 81% agree with the sentence. And Greece, and again, there might be Greek citizens here. No? The Greeks are thinking at the level of 68% that this is a sentence that they approved. These are the two countries that were supposed to leave the euro area, one down, the other one up, if I may, in the time of the crisis. And to the surprise of many observers, they did not at all, as you know. But they did not because the people didn't want to. So it is a story which is so different of the present narrative that you very often have in the rest of the world and from time to time in Europe too. So I thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, good afternoon everyone. My name is Yelena, I'm from Russia. This is Severin from Germany. And today we discuss basically two papers that Mr. Trichet kindly provided us with. Basically, it's a report and a paper. And before to start, maybe I would like to thank you for, we would like to thank you for coming. It's really a great honor for us to be able to discuss with you, to interact and to provide maybe our quite heterodox opinion on this point. Yes, so. First of all, we will make a short summary, mixed summary of both papers. I will start with presentation of monetary policy and some global policy in the global financial crisis. Then I will explain problems of exit strategies, and Severin will explain the future of central banking and will provide some important concluding remarks. And of course, at the end, we will open up and develop the discussion section. So to start with, as we know, central banks responded with a very unprecedented and quite aggressive measures to global financial crisis, and you can see them here. So basically, the first one is a record low interest rate. Basically, we can show the graph, the next one. Basically, interest rate of central bank is a very conventional instrument to guarantee the monetary stability, but in the case of global financial crisis, countries react really in extreme and aggressive and very coordinated, internationally coordinated way. So we can see that in 2008, basically, yes, 2007, at the end of 2007 first, the Federal Reserve agreed to lower the interest rate, and then other countries and other central banks decided to do the same. And this was the case of expansionary monetary policies. However, there is, if you've been very attentive to this graph, you can see one small deviation point. And in fact, this is a European Central Bank. And in 2011, European Central Bank decided to raise rates. But in fact, we can suggest that it was too early, and most probably, after that, we still had crisis at this moment, and we can suggest that maybe this measure affected the future of Greek crisis because it erupted, and it possessed a threat for the broader European Eurozone crisis. Then we can come back to the previous slide, and we can see the next measure is a forward guidance. Mr. Trichet already explained about it. Basically, it's, yes, we all agree that it's very important, and it's off balance measure to central banks to actually anticipate their decisions and to lower the uncertainty for all our market participants. And we know how crazy financial markets are and how crazy they react to information. So this is a very important point. And the aim was to affect and to lower medium rate, medium-term rate with forward guidance. Then the third point is actually, if we start to think about central banks before the crisis, we see that they didn't aim to lower the long-term rates, but just short-term, basically through bank interactions with bank. However, in the crisis, during the crisis, they had to implement ample liquidity provision and long-term refinancing. And Mr. Trichet was speaking about it when he was calling it illimited liquidity supply, right? So this is the case when our banks, they can have whatever they want, what they ask, at fixed rate, central bank will provide. So this is very important. Yes, the fourth point, intervention in different banks. So basically, if we take the example of US, the Federal Reserve had to intervene to money market funds because the main problem was with money market funds. And specifically, they've never done it before. So it was something unusual, something unprecedented, as we could call it. Something similar happened in Europe because Europe was started to buy covered bonds, and it was also something very unusual, which was not done before the crisis. And asset purchase programs. We can go to the graph also. I will show the balance, so we see the balance sheets of major central banks, and in fact, 2008. In 2008, we can see the jump in the size of balance sheets. It can indicate that this particular European Central Bank, Federal Reserve, and Bank of England, they started to purchase a lot of government bonds. Not government. It was not the case. Not the government bonds, but assets. And this can suggest us that, but unfortunately, they could not sell it back to the market because there were no demand for that. So in this case, we can see this jump and exceed of assets. If we compare to the program implemented by the Federal Reserve in 2011, so the Federal Reserve is in green, the program was called Operation Twist, and it consists, basically it's also when you purchase assets, but the assets swap. So basically you don't have the increase in balance sheet, so this is what we can see here, because you purchase long-term government bonds and you sell back short-term government bonds. Yes, and let's go to, yes. Yes, and one more interesting point that during the crisis, central banks were very much more involved in the process, and sometimes they worked out of scope, so they performed something that they have never done before, especially if we take the case of Federal Reserve, who was actually trying to find buyers for some banks that were failing during the crisis. So this is something which is really unprecedented. Yes, forward guidance. I don't know why we have forward guidance. Yes. Okay, and so as we understood, monetary policies, they've been quite, they've been much more consistent compared to fiscal policies. Speaking about fiscal policies, we can say that at the beginning of the crisis, G20, they decided to implement expansionary policies. Then, a few years later, onward 2010, they just say, okay, now government, they need to start saving, they need to go austerity, so they change the policy. However, monetary policies during the crisis, they've been always expansionary. This is the main difference. Also, we provided, and in the papers, they discussed the two main goals of central banks. So the first one, to stabilize financial market. This is a classic land of last resort function. And to combat recession and stagnation, so to perform macro management of financial market. Here we want to stress one point about mainstream economics, because it seems that the mainstream economics was not really able to predict the crisis, to explain what is happening during the crisis, to suggest really what to do to our central banks. And it seems that central banks were acting, maybe I should not say that, but without really a stable theoretical background, so they didn't have any strong background for the actions that they were performing during the crisis. And speaking about these two goals, we can say that central bank have been fairly successful at achieving the first goal, but for instance, we did not have any bank collapses or some crisis in stock market, but less successful in achieving the second goal, so stagnation. Yes, and with this respect, we can say that now a lot of people in academia and central bankers, they believe that there should be a moment when we should change our mind and we should stop using the expansionary monetary policies. But the main question, when and how do we end the period of these highly expansionary monetary policies? So with this regards, we have two main dangers. Dangers of early exit. So if you exit early, you can easily go back to recession. But if you stay, if you keep your rates too low for too long, it can also affect you in a bad way, and it might increase the potential for financial instabilities. Again, the role of forward guidance in this change is very important, because you have to explain to public and to all market participants what you are trying to do, what you are supposed to do in future. Because if we imagine that the central bank would just change their rates every day from, let's say, 1% to 5%, it would be a disaster. So it would be a great shock. So they should really communicate and explain clearly why and for which period we're going to keep the rates. And the next point is spillover effect on emerging market economies. This is something which is very important, and we can explain that as if we are using, for instance, quantitative easing in advanced market economies, so we lower the rates, and at this moment, all the capital will go to emerging market economies. And we can create booms, credit booms. However, after advanced market economies decide to change the policy, so they decide to abandon expansionary monetary policy, all the capital will flow back. So this is very important implication for emerging market economies, and we can see that if advanced economies change something in their practice, it will have an effect for sure on emerging market economies. And the last important point is about monetary policies, and is it able to resolve the crisis by itself? And the answer is no, and there are a lot of economists who believe that there should be some reforms done. However, they have different reforms in mind, but at least the understanding that we should move and we should change, it's present and it's here. And now we are going to, yes, the future.
Yeah, so I'm just gonna try to outline some points regarding what is the future of central banking and monetary policy in light of the financial crisis, and that was of course also a major theme of the two papers that were provided to us. And we can ask a lot of questions here when we think about that. The first one we can think about is what should be the objectives of central banks in the future. Before the crisis, we had this sort of consensus that, you know, price stability is the thing. So we can think about what should be the future role of price stability. If we go beyond mainstream economic approaches, is inflation targeting still possible? And if it's possible, is it still desirable? These are issues we can think about if we want to move away from inflation targeting. Should we maybe give more weight to output growth, to high employment? There are some economists who have suggested that central banks should, instead of targeting inflation, should start to target nominal GDP. Then there's the possibility, which we also heard about, that financial stability should become an objective of central bank policy, which we will come back to a lot more later. Then there are the distributional consequences of monetary policy, which have been of particular concern to heterodox economists, and that is related to some of the questions we're going to ask later. And then if we agree that price stability is no longer the sole objective of central bank policy, but that we want to go for some combination of objectives, whatever may be price stability and financial stability, then the question is, what weighting do we apply? Which measure is more central? And in many cases, how do we actually measure success? As we heard, there is, with regard to price stability, at least between central banks, there exists a consensus that it's 2%, but there are actually very interesting debates about how do we measure financial stability. What is a good measure for financial stability? Or also even if we want to talk about targeting employment, depending on our theoretical perspective, we might have different views on when an economy has reached full employment, for example. If financial stability becomes a more important political objective, then the question is, to what extent should central banks be responsible for achieving that objective? And we heard a little bit about that as well. So for example, we could say that, yeah, the central bank should work on implementing macroprudential regulation. And then the question is, should they also be involved in microprudential regulation and banking supervision? And this is related to something that some commentators have raised, a problem that they perceived as having been there before the crisis, that in some countries, you had a great many different agencies that were dealing with different aspects related to financial regulation and financial stability, which in the end led to the problem that no single agency had an overview of the whole, and there was too much sharing of responsibilities, which overall led to problems. The next question is, if financial stability becomes an objective of central bank policy, what's the best way to achieve it? There are some people who argue that the central bank should use the conventional tool of the policy interest rate to lean against the wind, that is, to try and slow down credit growth by raising interest rates. Again, you could argue against that by saying that actually the policy interest rate is too blunt of a tool to achieve that, because if you raise the policy interest rate only to target credit growth in one particular sector, you might take the whole economy down with it. And then if we agree that instead we need other policy measures other than the interest rate, we can think about what are the best macroprudential policy measures to promote financial stability. We've seen the ones that have been implemented as a consequence of the Basel III, but there are also some old and new measures that we might want to consider. So, for example, we had the direct credit controls that you had in Britain in the 1970s. I believe in France at one point you had the types of asset-based reserve requirements that Tom Pally has been advocating recently. And then if we look at the work of Minsky, we can find some more or less clearly spelled out proposals for new regulations and new prudential policy that we might want to think about. Yeah, in all this, there's clearly a role for heterodox economic analysis. On the one hand, of course, we have the Minskyan tradition with its long-standing focus on financial instability and the consequences for financial regulation. We also have different approaches to modeling the macroeconomy, which recently institutions like the Bank of England have become interested in. And also, if we just look at the basic presuppositions of heterodox approaches like the post-Keynesians, then we can say that, in a way, their very basic outlook on the economy has given them an advantage in being able to look at issues which were not present in mainstream economic analysis, like the importance of distribution or the emergence of the shadow banking system, which were of concern to heterodox economists well before they made it into mainstream research. One issue that's also addressed in the papers that were sent to us is whether there should be a permanent role in central bank policy for unconventional monetary policy, in the sense either of unconventional policy measures or intervention in different markets, as we heard, for example, the Fed during the crisis started lending to money market funds, which they weren't doing before. So there's one guy who's been advocating this, Perry Merling, who says that particularly in the market-based system of the United States, that the Fed should become a dealer of last resort, which should ensure continuous funding liquidity in all wholesale money markets. So that would imply that you have a permanent role for these unconventional policy measures, and you don't just go back to just using the interest rate once the crisis and the stagnation is over. Another important point is, if say we agree that the central bank of a country should target both price stability, however we want to define it, and financial stability, however we want to define it, then there's the question whether there's a potential for conflicts between these two objectives, and that's been a very active debate in some circles. Mm-hmm. So, for example, we could imagine a situation in which we have a macroprudential policy which tends to increase rates, for example, by increasing capital requirements, tends to increase lending rates at banks, at the same time as we have a macro environment which would induce the central bank from its price stability objective to lower rates. And, you know, we can kind of see that before the crisis, as Mr. Trichet was saying, from the sort of traditional inflation targeting perspective, everything looked fine. Whereas if we had looked at the right indicators and we had had the sort of macroprudential regulations that we had today, they would have indicated that we should be tightening macroprudential policy, which would have tended to raise bank lending rates. Overall, this is a hot topic, both in all of these issues are pretty hot topics, both in the orthodox and in the heterodox literature. And obviously public institutions are very interested and luckily also somewhat open to alternative approaches. In conclusion to all this, we can say that even though we can agree that at least among central banks maybe there has been convergence on some issues, there are still many open questions and few definitive answers. The debates continue on issues such as whether or not you should lean, central banks should lean against the wind, or how important potential conflicts between different policy measures might be. Among central banks, at least, there tends to be a consensus that price stability remains a central objective of monetary policy, and overall, the papers that were provided seem to argue that the old framework is more or less intact in this respect. There also appears a consensus that appears to be a consensus among central banks that central banks should take at least some responsibilities related to providing for financial stability. But again, there are still debates on what are the best instruments, the best measures of financial stability. A point that's also frequently made by the papers that we were given is that macro management must go beyond monetary policy, which in a way somehow stands in contrast to the sort of models that central banks relied on prior to the crisis, in which kind of monetary policy sort of was the only game in town, really. Although, of course, if we agree that we must go beyond monetary policy and macro management, then we very quickly get into debates where what kinds of reforms we think are appropriate, we are probably going to disagree on, and the disagreements are going to run along political lines. In general, answering many of these questions requires more research, for instance, on issues such as the evolution of the shadow banking system after the crisis and what should be the appropriate regulatory responses to that. And as said above, heterodox economists can make a major contribution to all of these areas, but only if public institutions remain open to their input and if they are prepared to challenge basic presets. Then we move on to our questions, which we have quite a few.
Quite quickly, because
Right. So you suggest in the papers that you sent us, and also you repeated that in your presentation, that central banks should begin or go back to using monetary aggregates and measures of aggregate credit growth as indicators. And my question would be quite basically, to what extent can this really help us? Because to me, financial instability depends not only on the amount, on some gross amount of debt, but also on its distribution, on the quality of the underlying credit relationships, and on the institutional structure of the financial sector, which implies that you need detailed research to identify potential sources of financial instability, and that central banks should perhaps not be paying too much attention to some arbitrary aggregate, and especially not try to target some such aggregate. And you know, we can relate these ideas to a fairly obscure school of thought on monetary policy, which you can actually trace back all the way to the anti-bullionists and to the banking school, which was precisely about this idea that central banks should not focus on the quantity of credit in an economy, but on the quality of that credit, and to identify the instabilities and the imbalances that build up within that system, and to make targeted interventions rather than trying to target some aggregate. The next question is, because you approvingly quote Minsky at various points, but then at one point in your speech you go back to the phrase that in the long run inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomenon. And my question would be, if we recognize, as Minsky does in some of his works at least, that the stock of money in the economy is determined endogenously by the demand for credit, how can we still maintain that there runs causality from the stock of money to the level of prices and not the other way around? Now, one might argue, but one might respond to that by invoking the natural rate of interest, but the problem is here that you also seem quite sympathetic to approaches in complexity economics featuring multiple equilibria and path dependence, in which it's actually not so straightforward anymore whether you have a natural rate of interest and how that is determined.
Yeah. Take two, three more minutes, then.
I mean, this is something I pointed to earlier. At one point in the document, I think it's in the G30 one, there's the argument that because unconventional monetary policies have distributional implications, they are problematic from a political economy perspective, and might go beyond a central bank's mandate, especially when they become a permanent feature. However, when I read that, I thought that, you know, there's a big literature, especially in the Marxian and Strathian and post-Keynesian traditions, which emphasizes that all monetary policy has distributional consequences because interest rates are distributional variables. So I wonder really to what extent is that really an argument against unconventional monetary policy? I mean, if central banks have the mandate to do the one, why don't they have the mandate to do the other? And, you know. And the last question from my side is really that I noticed when I read the paper that to an extent to me they seemed somewhat theoretically incoherent, in that on the one hand they tended to be quite open to approaches that you can argue that an economy can be stuck below full employment in the long run. That there's hysteresis, that that economies are complex systems featuring multiple equilibria and path dependence, but in the end they always seem to go back to policy proposals which seem to me to be derived from a more mainstream system in which you have a unique Nairu, a natural rate, and so on. And all of these policy conclusions are not so straightforward anymore once we go beyond that framework. So my question to you would be, How do these two things fit together?
Okay, last question. 1 minute.
Okay. Very fast. So I will not go into detail. I will just present how it is. So what does the Eurozone crisis tell us about the design flaws of the euro? Because, and what does the ECB's response tell us about its political independence? Its go to crisis in Greece and... all this, I can develop it after if we will have more time, but like that, like now we keep like that. And the next question, what is your view regarding proposals for a separation of commercial and investing banking? This is argued in the literature that there should be separation to fight against lobbying of huge banks and to prevent that. So how would you comment on that, and do you believe that it's necessary to separate the banks? Yes, and...
Oh, we
might need to skip the slide. It's fine. It's fine. We had more questions, but it's fine.
We need to be fair for this question.
Je reprends la place. Oui, d'accord.
If you could respond quickly to this point, that would require hours and hours, and we are aware of this, of developments, and then we'll take questions from all of the world, including the Brazilian mafia.
So, first of all, thank you very much indeed. It was all very good questions, and of course all points that were mentioned as being open are very welcome. We are in a world where we have to be aware of certain things. There are very, very large issues that are open. Nevertheless, this belief that in any case, solidly anchoring inflation expectations over the medium and long run, not on a short run or even on the medium run basis, but in the medium and long run, is really something which we trust remains very important, has been reinforced, I would say, in the crisis. So I take the various remarks, not only the questions, but the remarks, because some remarks were in the form of questions. For instance, very wisely, you said there is a hump in the interest rates. So how do you explain? I understand I have to explain the hump. I see three remarks that might, you know, be useful. First, our own understanding, when I say my, I mean the governing council of the ECB, had the vision, which we maintained in the crisis, that what was the most important was to solidly anchor medium-long-term expectations with the traditional instrument that are the interest rates in order to avoid both inflation and deflation. Avoiding deflation proved certainly very wise, taking into account the materialization, but long, long after those decisions, of certain deflationary risk. Protecting against inflation was, and I put myself, you know, as president of the ECB in 2010-2011. In 2010, I decided to purchase treasuries of Greece, Ireland, and Portugal. It was something which was considered abominable, as you might remember, you German citizen, in Germany, in all circles in Germany. I had no support at all. Of course, the consequence was to diminish massively the interest rates in these three countries. And also by way of demonstration that we were there and we would care for the, I would say, interest rates at Frankfurt to be transmitted correctly to all parts of the euro area, you know, the non-conventional measure in terms of, you know, applied to Europe in 2010, 2011, and then with the OMT, was meaning much lower rates than what you would have had spontaneously. So to present, and I mentioned the fact that the presentation is always the presentation of the mainstream, and the mainstream look at the US. The US has nothing which would look like that. But my main you know, objective was to demonstrate that we were inflexible on the anchoring of inflation expectation for the euro area as a whole, and to be as free as possible to embark in the appropriate non-standard measures, even if they were shocking. And they were. And in 2011, I intervened massively on the treasuries in Spain and Italy. So it was another dimension. We were intervening massively in five countries in the euro area, representing 38% of the GDP of the euro area. And the consequence, you know, in comparison, of course, with the counterfactual, what would have happened in terms of interest rates in the euro area had we not taken those measures, would have been absolutely dramatic. You know, the spreads were skyrocketing. So that is something which I think is important. Now, if I make my own, you know, we have no journalist here, my own, you know, meditation. This idea, the separation principle I mentioned, and I was public on that, was of course for me one way to tell the German, the Austrian, the north of Europe, you can rely on this institution. We are delivering price stability, we'll continue to deliver price stability without inflation and without deflation. And at the same time, to tell, well, the non-standard measures, the purchase of public and a little bit private tradable securities is something different, which is, you know, commanded by the crisis and the exceptional difficult crisis in which we are, but it does not impact the long-term stability of your currency, you Austrian, you Finns, you Dutch, you German, and so forth. And it might very well be that, you know, it was, you know, I mean, when you are responsible vis-à-vis hundreds of millions of people, you might reason a little bit like that. But of course, this has nothing to do with the way the US would reason, and nothing to do with a period where I would have had a real problem of deflation. But at that time, the inflation was high, and there was some threat of looking at part of the euro area embarking on abnormal behavior, because we were about to have a non-occurring, even if it was paradoxical because we had a big crisis, but we had a threat of non-occurring upward of the inflation expectations. But to present, as it has been the case in some circles, the ECB as being incredibly ultra-orthodox, and this is more or less the vision from the US, is stupid, because at the same time we were taking decisions that were highly unorthodox and very, very aggressively criticized, as the German citizens know. Other, I would say, remark which will consolidate my position as ultra-orthodox: austerity. Again, coming from the US, you have no external constraint. You can do, or you think you can do, whatever you want. So you can have permanently a debate: shouldn't we much more accommodating? Should not the fiscal policy should be much more aggressive, and so forth? And as you might know, there is a large consensus on the US, Trump plus the left of the Democratic Party, which criticized permanently Obama as being a little bit too austere, quote-unquote. In Europe, we were in a totally, unfortunately, in totally different situation. There was no choice in Greece, in Spain, in Portugal. The rest of the world was telling them, we do not want to finance you anymore. What do you do when the rest of the world tells you, I don't want to finance you anymore? You have not, you know, many opportunities. Either you say, I don't care, okay, and then you have a crisis which is abominable, and you have to handle and manage the crisis. Or you say, well, could you help me, you European and you, I would say, international community, to do what I understand I have to do to get back from minus X percent of deficit, which is frightening the entire world. I'm speaking both, I would say, of the current account deficit and of the public finance deficit. And it is what all countries have asked. They said, okay, we will try to get progressively back to an appropriate level of creditworthiness. We understand that this is, you know, the rule, but help us. And you know that all the other citizens, the German, the French, and all others, have helped considerably the Greeks, and also the Irish and the Portuguese, not to speak a little bit of the Spanish. So this idea that you criticize austerity violently and vehemently on countries that proved a moment before that they had no more credibility and nobody wanted to finance them apart their friends. And it was not that easy for the IMF to convince Brazil and others, speaking of Brazil again, that they had to help the Greeks, because it is what the IMF is doing. With the credit and the money of the rest of the world, they were helping those who had difficulty in Europe. It was not easy at all, and there was a lot of criticism on the fact that it was too gentle and too kind and so forth. So the criticism should be directed towards the previous governments that accumulated bad management in many countries, obviously, up to a level of imbalances that was really dramatic. And I can tell you, since 2005, I was circulating myself the evolution of the unit labor cost in all countries in Europe, and we are back to one of your questions, design flows of the euro, countries in the euro area, evolution of unit labor cost, even evolution of the wages and salaries in the civil service, because I could tell the ministers of finance, you are responsible for that. Don't tell me that it is the market economy, the real economy functioning spontaneously. No, it's you. You decide on the wages and salary and of the public sector. And I already said that last year, I guess. But augmentation of wages and salaries in Greece, in Greece, in Ireland, and in Portugal, since the setting up of the euro up to the start of the sovereign risk crisis, which was end of 2009, beginning of 2010. In Greece, plus 117%, in Ireland, 110% in euros, and in Portugal, probably 75%. In Germany, 20%. Augmentation of wages and salaries in euros, same international purchasing power, same international cost in euros, 20, 117, 110, and 75. And these were the three first countries or economies to have major problems when the sovereign risk crisis came. So you can identify very clearly that for a number of reasons, and it was not easy for the governments of these countries to manage the situation, but clearly there was benign neglect at the level of the nations concerned and at the level of the European institution. And it's true that we had no pillar to govern that particular point. So if you say it was one of the design, I would say anomaly, in the euro, we had a good, in my opinion, Stability and Growth Pact, which nevertheless is criticized very heavily, wrongly so, in my understanding. And we paid a very high price for the benign neglect vis-à-vis the Stability and Growth Pact. And those who respected the Stability and Growth Pact were rewarded fantastically, including Germany, in terms of full employment and so forth. But it is also, of course, true that we had no pillar to monitor the evolution of cost competitiveness in the various countries. We have it now. It's not easy to say whether it is applied very seriously by the Commission, but that's another story. It is called, fortunately in English it is a little bit easier than in other languages, it is the Macroeconomic Imbalance Procedure, the MIP. If you could memorize that the MIP is as important as the SGP today as pillars of governance in the euro area, I think it's a strong message. As important, but not necessarily applied as with great determination. I was very interested in all the remarks on price stability versus financial stability, leaning against the wind. It's absolutely clear that there is a big debate there. We did not unite our understanding of the situation. I am in the camp of those who think that leaning against the wind is probably something which is justified. If there is no leaning against the wind, what is the use of looking at what's happening on the credit side, on the financial side in general? And in my opinion, it's not that that difficult to make the link with the goal of price stability, because if you have at any moment the explosion of your piling up of debt outstanding, and I agree fully that it has to be looked at very carefully, as the ECB is doing. I mean, we, since a very, very long time, the Europeans are not saying we are looking only at the whole of the aggregates, and we, on the contrary, we worked enormously on understanding better the various components. But what do you have when it explodes? Either inflation or deflation. So it's absolutely clear that financial stability has, if we are going to financial instability, it has an enormous bearing on price stability. So I think really that leaning against the wind is a presentation which, of course, the US do not like it too much because there has been a lot of theory on the fact that we were absolutely right of pursuing relatively loose monetary policy during all the period going up to the crisis. In my own country, which is not very orthodox, frankly speaking, the mainstream in the country is not liking too much to be told we have to be wise, both, I would say, in terms of fiscal policies, in terms of wages and salaries. Wage moderation is important to fight against unemployment and so forth. We have a culture which is a little bit, from that standpoint, not in my view absolutely optimal. But when we had the crisis, I remember the change, the swing in the French public opinion that was absolutely fantastic. To say, but finally, all those who are claiming that we should be as laxist as possible, look at what happened now. So, only to mention the fact that I really trust that even if we do not agree all on that, there is a real point there and a real matter for academia to work on it, on the link between the two again. At a time, it's only a question of time, but at a certain moment, then your piling up of debt outstanding explodes and you have to pay the price in terms of price and stability. So I'm going to the question. I already responded on the detailed research. Absolutely necessary. I fully agree on aggregate. I don't remember to whom I am responding, but I take it that you work together. Detailed research, absolutely necessary. Certainly no aggregation. But again, the counterpart, part of the counterpart of the monetary aggregates are credit growth, and I recommend a very, very, and it seems to me that we have quite a large consensus, at least inside the central banks, on looking very, very carefully and in the most detailed possible way. Minsky, I noted something, but I must confess that the Minsky analysis before the explosion of the crisis seemed to me the most enlightening, and I, in retrospect, it's difficult to understand fully why it was largely ignored. I take it the remark was he recommends not to look at money, and again. We are looking at the counterpart of money and at credit, and it is exactly what Minsky is mentioning. The I would say hypothesis of financial instability is precisely that. It goes up and up and up and up, and at a certain moment it explodes. The equilibrium rate of interest, I fully agree that this is a unicorn. I mean, it does not exist. It is like the Nairu. We have to make a lot of assumptions to compute an equilibrium rate of interest. I have the suspicion that to justify during a long period very low interest rates, it's good to be able to say, well, the underlying real equilibrium rate is very, very low or even negative. I take that with a grain of salt. I'm prudent, I'm cautious. Distributional consequence. I fully agree on the fact that interest rates have an impact in terms of distribution consequence. It's absolutely right. But it's true also that when you de facto intervene directly on all duration and massively on all duration, you are augmenting, if I may, the direct distributional effect of what you do. Because again, your instrument is incredibly more sophisticated and powerful in some respect. In the other case, you are only touching a part of the yield curve and you let the market decide what to do with that, with a lot of other factors. So I think that it is justified to ask whether or not central banks are fully able to be totally free. I mean, I'm for the independence of the central bank, and I made an éloge of the independence of the central bank precisely when they decide to embark on this extraordinary non-conventional measures. So I will continue to say that. But we are living in democracies. We are living in, you know, opinion democracy. It's normal that there is a debate on that inside academia, in the public opinion. I think that we have to fully accept that. As I said, it seems to me that all central bankers were quite easily able to say, well, the assets associated with what we do or did are very largely superior to the liabilities associated with it in terms of distortion of markets. When I was separating the various goals that are pursued, I have to say that the goal which is absolutely, definitively unchallengeable is avoiding a dramatic crisis 29-30 like. That cannot be disputed. The other goals are more subtle. And if we say now the new normal is that the central bank can permanently be interested by the full body of the yield curve, and I would feel a little bit uneasy personally. So I hope, and that is also part of the European ECB legacy, this should be transitory. Now, the exit strategy remains a big, big question mark. And we can see in the case of the US that even when you say the economy goes well, we are at full employment, which is not necessarily fully the case, and we are increasing rates from now on, you have still your 4 trillion. And the 4 trillion, again, seems to be there for quite a period of time. Because if the taper tantrum was a shock, but another shock would be we will start to sell our treasuries or our tradable securities. It would be very terrible. I responded a little bit of the design flow of the euro. Say, to oversimplify, at the very beginning we had the Stability and Growth Pact, but we did not respect the Stability and Growth Pact. We had no MIP, macroeconomic imbalance procedure. We had no banking union, and even less, of course, capital market union. So, and we had no ESM, European Stability Mechanism, to combat speculation coming from markets. So, clearly, we have improved considerably in the crisis. And we will see whether we do the hard work which goes with these new pillars of governance. It is also a demonstration of the fact that we are, I mean, in Europe, it is history in the making. The United States was not done by a snapshot. What we are doing in Europe is also something which moves. And the presentation, which is very often the presentation in the rest of the world, which says, look, it's a very bold experience, it will not stand at a certain moment, it will collapse, and the UK departure is the first, how would you say, petal of the flower, you know? How would you say that? The leaf, you know? Not the leaf, no, la pétale de la marguerite.
We understand you.
La pétale de la marguerite. So you know what I mean.
Yeah.
So it's plain wrong, of course, absolutely plain wrong. And when I look at the euro area, we were 15 countries in the euro area at the moment of Lehman Brothers. The 15 are still there, and I told you what were the last December survey as regards the attachment to the euro, it's even in Greece. So the 15 are still there, even Greece. And 4 new countries came in. So today we are 19 in the euro area. And the 4 new countries, sovereign countries coming in, were coming in at the moment of the crisis, after Lehman Brothers. So it tells a lot on the resilience of the historical endeavor, which is the European endeavor. Now, the last question was on commercial banking versus investment banking. To say that it would permit to diminish the lobby, the financial lobby, look, the major investment banks are all American. There is no other investment bank than the US banks. And they are incredibly powerful globally, because again, you have no equivalent neither in Europe nor in Japan. So, and I'm not sure. And on top of that, the US is in a totally different situation. So the investment banking is concentrating, of course, on markets and functioning of markets. And the commercial banks are representing a fraction, which is quite modest, as I said, of the financing of the US economy. So we are in a different universe. The European banks are more attached to a mix of the two. Universal banking. I think it corresponds more to what is necessary in Europe, personally. If you do not want to be dogmatic, and if you want to have banks that would give the service, in particular to the enterprises, that is necessary, because you have to do a little bit of investment banking. But they have no ambition to be the equivalent of Goldman Sachs or Morgan Stanley of Merrill Lynch and so forth. So we are in different universe there.
Thank you. So we will pick up
maybe you will be able to answer also one of the Severin questions about the fact that Bank of England, for instance, have really tried to look at other models, introduced other types of approaches, which are probably not at ECB for the moment. So do you think that ECB has a very big... But maybe we will gather no. other questions.
I take your question.
You take the question.
Okay. I take your question.
Don't forget to introduce yourself in the country. Okay. Good afternoon. Okay, I'm Martin. I'm from Argentina. So this is a broad question, but just to know your comments or your opinion regarding the development of a regional central bank for South America. So what would be your opinion regarding that situation?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'm Marta, I'm from Poland, but my question will also be on Latin America, because I'm writing my thesis on this. So I'm sure you're aware of very high inflation right now in Venezuela, which might already be called hyperinflation. So could you comment on what, in your opinion, is the cause of this phenomenon? Is it purely a monetary phenomenon of, you know, excessive money supply and printing machine of the government? Or, as we study in our masters, there's an alternative approach to the generation of hyperinflation, the post-Keynesian approach, where it is treated as a distributional conflict between different classes, where workers demand higher wages, they are granted those wages, and then firms want to recover higher costs and they push up prices, and this causes wage price inflation. So could you what is your opinion on such an approach?
But you're working on Venezuela yourself?
Yeah, I'll be working on my master's.
My name is Tom, I'm from Brazil and I'm from Argentina. So I wanted to know more about what drives your optimism regarding the euro, given that Italy is on the brink of, was on the brink of a financial crisis. We have Trump, which I don't even need to say anything, and the Brexit. And it seems to me that there are more sources of instability than sources of stability. And my opinion, my impression, my intuition is that we are walking on thin ice right now. And this source of inertia of the European Union to actually realize the political forces that are acting right now and that are profoundly destabilizing might lead to another disaster. So I would like to understand more your source of opinion, and if it relates only to opinion pools of people or actually these kind of things.
Okay.
Hello, my name is...
Okay.
My name is Magdalena. I'm from Germany, and I would like to ask, since you highlighted like the importance of austerity in Southern Europe because of high wage level, etc., what would speak against an adjustment from the surplus countryside with more investment in Germany? Because I know the case from Germany, there's a big discussion about underinvestment, especially in public infrastructure, etc., and why wouldn't be an adjustment from the surplus countryside through more investment? Why wouldn't this be more desirable than painful internal devaluation in Southern European countries? Thank you.
My name is João Pedro. I'm from Brazil, and I will ask you a question about central bank independence. That you mentioned that it was important in the moment of crisis because of undertaking quick measures to respond to it. But in the other hand, recently in Brazil, interest rates is known to be very high, and the central bank decided to reduce interest rates only after the parliament decided to adopt very strict fiscal rules. So in a sense, it was kind of bargaining with the Congress to approve these measures for be able to reduce interest rates. So my question is how to draw this line of the independence of central bank, because the parliament was elected and the central bank was not elected.
Answers for 5 to 10 minutes, then we have the second round in order to
okay, and we
finish at five.
We finish at five, yeah. Sharp.
Okay.
Okay. Argentina, South America Central Bank. I mean, again, the European have embarked after World War II in this extraordinary historical endeavor, which started with the speech in 50, year 50, so we are now 66 years after. And it was based very, very much, I have to say, on a multi-dimensional, concept. Peace and stability, geostrategic stability in Europe after 1, 2, 3, 4 major wars, either at the level of Europe as a whole, or between the Prussian and the French, or between the entire world, World War I, World War II. So that was something very, very strong, which is present in continental Europe and not present in the UK, for instance, because the UK was not in the same situation. That's very important. Then you have a second dimension, which was the economy of scale, having a single, we call it at the beginning, common market in the 50s, that would be of the size of the United States of America, economy of scale at the size of the United States and so forth. And there is a third dimension, which is the, I would say, fact that the continent, not immediately, but progressively, wanted to exist in history, at the level of the planet, and not being subject of the, action or bets of the big powers and not of themselves. The three dimensions are there, and probably much more than is suspected, looking at it from the US or from the new hemisphere or from Latin America or from Asia. So I draw your attention to that. I'm not sure that you have the same very profound reason to unite in Latin America. But it is clear that, as I said, we are experiencing ourselves a fantastic, endeavor, historical endeavor, and we are learning a lot, taking advantage of time elapsing and also of the crisis itself. As I said, a lot of things have been invented in the crisis. And perhaps at the time, Latin America, which is so closely united with the same culture, more or less, not exactly the same language, but languages that are close, obviously, and with a lot of facility to go from Portuguese to Spanish. So it seems to me that at a time you might find this very, very interesting and stimulating. Today, I'm not sure that I feel the urgency of this endeavor. Poland, Venezuela. Venezuela is a basket case, an abominable basket case. It's not that country is not governed. Is not so. We are back to what we had observed in the ancient past in Latin America. Very fortunately, it is not the case, neither in Brazil nor in any other Latin American country, to my knowledge. And we will see what happens, but all possible reasons are there to explain the hyperinflation of Venezuela. But we could see that in the past in Argentina, we could see that in Brazil. I mean, it's I don't think that you will discover new channels that are not necessarily already known in Venezuela. And it's a pity because the Venezuela has a lot of assets, not only its people, but its the waste of the oil and resources is terrible. I know a little bit Venezuela. I think it's a very sad story, obviously.
On what is the ultimate cause? So for you, is it just due to excessive money supply that they were just printing?
No, there is no, the country is not run. So the poor central bank, I don't see what they could do. You know, it's a system, and the system is not managed. So how would you stop it then? Pardon me?
How would you stop it? I mean, how would you now stop this?
There would be at a time probably a change of government and a totally different policy which would be implemented. And the people are suffering a lot from mismanagement. Good management, my own experience, is rewarded. Bad management is punished. And the paradox, of course, is that when you manage very poorly during a certain period of time, you're applauded by your people, which does not see that they are going to the catastrophe. It's exactly what happened in Greece during a long period of time. And then, of course, instead of putting the blame of those who mismanage, you put the blame of those who are trying to recover and put the country on the right tracks. So, but this is human nature. That makes a point which, for me, is I could see all countries in Europe and in the world in some respect. You know, the main competitive advantage of nations today is the lucidity of their public opinion. If you have a lucid public opinion, they don't accept the reasoning of demagogues. And demagogues are not, you know, getting at the center of the country, but it is because the people are lucid. If the people are not lucid, they pay a price for absence of lucidity. But that's my personal remark, not too much a financial one or an economic one. So I am now on Brazil. Yeah, the euro. Your questions on the euro were very well reflecting, of course, the mainstream presentation, which is coming, I say that quite sadly, not from continental Europe, against the evidence. Because what happened? We had the worst crisis ever since World War II and perhaps since World War I. It didn't come in Europe, it came in Wall Street and in the financial sector. But clearly, starting point, we know where it was. So to transform that as European bashing and so forth seems to me a little bit an exaggeration. It was Wall Street which was about to collapse. And there was not two Lehman Brothers, there has been only one in the United States of America. Now, the usual projection was the euro will not stand in such a situation where we have an abominable financial and monetary crisis implicitly, and the euro area will explode and be dismantled. I already responded We are now 8 years after the start of the crisis Lehman Brothers, I would say, like, and I would say 9 years after the start of the subprime crisis. The euro was never disappearing. On the contrary, I would say the main criticism on the euro was that it was too strong, which is a paradox for a currency which is supposed to be as fragile and vulnerable as was affirmed. And I already responded on the 15 becoming 19. So if one is pragmatic, if one looks at Europe, it must say, bizarre. They are telling me permanently that they are about to collapse and be, blown up. And I see exactly the contrary. I accept fully that this is true from the very existence of the endeavor and of the concept of the euro area and so forth. I accept fully that it does not, prove that we have a fantastic economy and that we have eliminated mass unemployment everywhere, which is our goal, of course. But things are very often presented as we are about to be dismantled. It is plain wrong. And those who bet on our dismantling lost a lot of money. But that's another story. Germany, adjustment in Germany too, absolutely right. The macroeconomic imbalance procedure is symmetric. And of course, there is an asymmetry in time of crisis because there were countries that were not being able to finance themselves. So that is a problem. And as I explained, you have no choice there. Either you explode yourself or you ask your friends to help you, which was done. The friends helped. But at the level of the euro area as a whole, the macro equilibrium and policy of the euro area calls for countries like Germany with over-competitiveness and a big current account surplus of 8.5% of the GDP to activate their domestic demand, whether it is because wages and salaries would be much more dynamic. I take it that it is what is going on and it's exactly what is appropriate in the present. Yeah. It is appropriate.
Yeah, but I'm just wondering whether this is really happening because Wolfgang Schäuble is too excited.
No, Wolfgang Schäuble is right, in my opinion, vis-à-vis the German people in saying fiscal balance is good. Because it augments, the German can be desperate if they have the feeling that things are going nowhere and they are embarking on deficit and so forth. So it's good to reinforce the confidence of the people because they have to consume, they have to purchase, they have to invest and so forth. So I'm not sure that Schäuble is wrong. But the German government should clearly, openly and less openly, encourage wages and salaries to go higher and investment to be much more active. Trump has no mean. He's in deficit, Trump. He has no mean to make a lot of investment in the US. Germany has a lot of savings to finance the private investment that could be done or the public-private venture that could be done. So I fully agree with you on that point. And even if it is not easy to understand that you were so well managed that now you have full employment and 8.5% of current account surplus, and the German normal citizens say, but why should I be punished because I behave so properly over time? After all, I only looked at having full employment, and it is true in a way. But normally, the unions should be a little bit more demanding. it would be a normal behavior in a market economy to say you have a lot of profits and we should share a little bit in the profits. So I would say a little bit of injection of German culture in France would be excellent and a little bit of injection of French culture in Germany would be fantastic. There is a complementary position there. I think new models. I really take it. I'm not sure that you're severe for the ECB. We worked. It has to be checked. Frankly speaking, I didn't look at it to be sure, but it was. And I would be very surprised if you do not have a lot of very good economists in the ECB working actively on the new modeling, because it's clear, even if they were very good in the previous modeling, and as all, I would say, intellectual, very attached to their own babies and production, but I really think that the ECB has all reasons, perhaps. Bank of England was better in communicating what they were trying, and I will look at it, because it's a very good question, and I'm sure that we have to get out of the box in any case. That is necessary.
Yeah, no, we're two.
The only?
Okay, so my question would be about the political forces that would have a role in the decision-making process in the UCB, because even though you've emphasized on central banking independence, I'm just going to take an example. During the Greek referendum in June, the UCB announced that it would cut the emergency liquidity assistance, and this is a fundamentally political decision. So I would like to perhaps have some of your insight on how the decisions are taken and the different stakes, how do they interact perhaps with the Commission and really on the political forces behind the decision-making process.
My name is Lilian, I'm from Brazil as well. And just going back to Venezuela, just a short comment. Because Venezuela, as far as I know, is suffering an embargo from the US. So I would question if it's only bad management, not that I'm all in favor of what they do, the government of Venezuela, but it's only bad management, or what a country under an embargo, a Latin American country under the embargo of such a big country and powerful as US has as possibilities.
French-speaking. Well, I'm happy that you mentioned the chief economist of the BIS. I guess you were referring to Bill White. So he's a Canadian, just like me. And I admire him for having taken this position in the early 2000s, saying that price stability is not the only good thing to worry about, and it was very courageous of him to take this position, and some of his colleagues at the BIS. But I have my question is about the story that you told us about the ECB in 2010, 2011, when there was this crisis in the Eurozone. Briefly speaking, my question is the following: Spain and the United Kingdom had both roughly the same current account deficit, and they both had roughly the same government deficit, budget deficit. So why is it that in the UK rates of interest remained at 2%, whereas in Spain they rose to about 7%?
Just a short question. My name is Andrei, I come from Ukraine. And during last 3 years, a lot of large commercial banks in my country became insolvent because of excessively large percentage of non-performing loans in the system, up to 40% in 2014, for example. And how would you define the degree of responsibility of the central bank, which is the national regulator, in this kind of situation?
Could you repeat slowly? I'm not sure I got exactly your question.
The problem in my country, I come from Ukraine.
Yeah, no, I know. My wife is Ukrainian, and my two sons are half Ukrainian.
And the problem during the last 3 to 5 years is that a lot of commercial banks become insolvent because of large percentage of non-performing loans in the system.
Okay.
How would you define the degree of responsibility of the national regulator in the past years for this kind of situation?
Okay, fine. So, last question?
No? It's okay.
It's okay.
No, it's up to you.
Bon. ECB political influence. All my experience is that decisions in the ECB are taken on the basis of the simple majority, enfin, the quasi-totality of the decision, and all decisions in monetary policy are taken by a simple majority of the governing council on the basis of one man or woman, one vote. And that is the rule. Even if we have changed a little bit the rule for some rotating to take for the augmentation of the number of economies in the euro area, but it is exactly that, you know. And every member is, you know, putting in his mind the superior interest of the euro area. I don't take it at all that the decision taken by the ECB was a political decision to influence in any respect Greece or whatever country. In time of crisis, the problem is not political influence coming from the outside world, the Commission or the governments or the Chancellerin or the President or whatever, on the ECB. It is, and I say that sadly so, the contrary. I myself sent a letter to Prime Minister Zapatero to tell him in 2011, and I refer to that previously, in a way to gain the right to tell a country which is that as big as Spain, you have to change your policy, otherwise nobody will want to finance you, and it's very important. And we decided on the basis of the response of Prime Minister Zapatero to inject a lot of money in purchasing the treasuries of Spain. And the same for Italy, with a letter to Berlusconi. So when you are at a time of crisis, it is really exceptionally difficult, I have to say, to manage that. And I can tell you, really, in his memoirs, Zapatero said he's not criticizing at all, and Berlusconi neither. So it's times of crisis are special times, frankly speaking. But you can trust the independence, in my opinion, of the ECB. Venezuela, U.S. influence, U.S. exert influence, to my knowledge. Whatever the president, everywhere in the world permanently, or try to do that with more or less success. Venezuela is a special case, frankly speaking. I stick to my understanding. It is a level of mismanagement which is really absolutely exceptional. And I do not want to elaborate more on that. Bill White, our friend, is a remarkable man. Very, very lucid. His analysis were right at a time where he was very much alone, and not entirely alone because we were a number of central bankers that had the suspicion that we were not in a very stable situation. Back to your question, Spain and the UK, of course, it is a very important issue. The present level, if I'm not misled, of current account deficit of the UK before the Brexit was probably 5.5% of the GDP or something like that. And the situation of the UK is not an easy one, in my own opinion. And of course, they had no reason to be in the situation of Spain because there was no dramatic crisis like the crisis of Spain, even if Spain succeeded in avoiding the, I would say, IMF recourse. And Spain only had recourse to the help for its banks by the other European, and they did a good job, frankly speaking. So if you let me a little time, I will dig more on that. I think that the idea that it's much, much better to be out of the euro area, if you look at the medium and long run, is probably plain wrong, because Spain had a big problem, obviously, after having grown fantastically, too much, obviously, much too much, but much more than the UK itself at a period where if I mention the average of the euro area and I mention the wages and salaries increases in Portugal, I said 75%. Spain, with an average in the euro area of 36, was probably at the level of 66 or something like that. There has been an episode of boom, which was absolutely fantastic, and was not equivalent to the UK boom. So it seems to me that you take a snapshot, but you don't take necessarily the previous period, which again, because we had no MIP, because it was very difficult for the Commission and for Spain itself to realize, like Ireland, that they had a very abnormal bubble, real estate bubble, crucially. The correction had to be quite strong. I give you a rendezvous in several years, because Spain is now, at least in current account, if I'm not misled, balanced, when the UK has still probably 5% of current account deficit. So you have a slight difference. It also, when you compare, Yeah, but they practically are back to the level of unemployment they had before. I don't think you can compare the figures as easily as you suggest. But okay, you know that I do not buy the argument you're better off out of the euro area. I don't buy that. But okay. I think
to care about the current account deficit or the government deficit in the UK. Why is it that people cared about what was happening about that in Spain when the situation was identical to that of the UK?
No,
they also had a real estate boom in the UK.
First of all, it was not identical. The markets are looking at what was happening, and they could see that there had been a big hump, which did not exist, to my knowledge, in the United Kingdom, but I didn't work on that, so you know better. Correct me if I'm wrong. Big hump, very big hump, a little bit Irish-like in Spain, not the same recent evolution since the euro started in the UK. Unless I'm totally wrong, I take it that this is something. Second, of course, at the very beginning, you know that the market, we are considering that there was no reason to treat differently any member of the euro area, which was wrong. We never said that there was an implicit guarantee inside the euro area, but they trusted that. And of course, when we had the trigger of Wall Street collapse, access also of the London problems, financial problems, and it came in the three countries I have been mentioning, the three small countries that I've been mentioning. The market scene from New York and from London were thinking that it was the system itself which was at stake. Fortunately, wrongly so, but it was what they were trusting, and they didn't see why, after Portugal, we could not go to the other countries, which in terms of market perception of the risk, and you could see the credit default swap, were the next online, exactly like in the US, you would say why Goldman Sachs could have some problems. After all, they were in a very different situation from Lehman Brothers. But we all know that had the US not blocked what was happening, it would have continued. So we blocked at the level of Spain and Italy a phenomenon which was very largely a systemic crisis, which it seems to me can be unfortunately explained by the combination of the past and of the fact that it is true that a number of countries were not managed well in the euro area.
What would you answer to the question? I mean, during your presentation, you mentioned that there were lots of pressures from some countries, in particular Germany, not to do anything, for the ECB not to intervene in those...
I said that?
Well, not yeah. Well, I mean...
Did I say that? Yes, but we took it.
Yeah. I'm not saying you didn't, but what would you answer to the what would be your answer to the question that perhaps the ECB acted too little, too late, in 2010, 2011? So, for instance, when the pressure started on Greece around December 2009, that this is when the ECB should have acted and to purchase Greek bonds, and then when things were going wrong in May 2010 with Greece, this is when the ECB could have done it, buy huge amounts of bonds from Italy, Portugal, I think it was mainly Portugal and Ireland, at a time when interest rates in those countries were still not so high.
It is precisely that we did. It is in May 10 that we intervened simultaneously on Greece, Ireland and Portugal, the three. Intervened in May 10. And with the clear perception that we had a systemic issue which was at stake. But it's very, very complex. If I may, we could pursue during... No, but why not taking rendezvous? And we will discuss that because it's, you know, we are, you have the Greek government and what they are able or not to do. You have the various other countries and whether they are able to take into account the situation. I could not intervene alone in any case. As you know, my own intervention was associated with, at least in theory, something like $1 trillion. That was mobilized by the IMF and by the governments to prove the markets that we were serious in countering the crisis. If the governments had been incapable to present that, our money would have been wasted purely and simply. So it's very complex. And then at a time we had the dramatic concept of private sector involvement. I don't know whether you worked on that. But that was a way to tell the speculative part of the market, why don't you speculate against us? Because the concept itself will be that those who are long will lose money and those who are short will make money out of their speculation. So I fought against all governments in Europe against this private sector involvement. And finally, we got out the private sector involvement only in July, end of July 2011, when the Chancellerin and the other members of the European Council understood that it was not, I would say, intelligent at all to have such a concept, which would be self-destroying at a moment where we were trying to redress the situation. The market were so convinced that the private sector involvement was part of the reasoning of the European that only 15 days after the Greek private sector had to abandon part of its credit, you remember the negotiation, the speculative part of the market attacked Spain and Italy. So all this is extremely complex. And the mistakes made by, I would say, governments during the period before the crisis, then in the crisis, or the difficulty to cope with the crisis, which is understandable when you have 15 different countries, 15 democracies, 15 public opinion, and various reasoning. The private sector involvement, which was the big mistake of the government during that period, from 10 to 11, was applauded by all parliaments in the important countries in Europe. You would have a majority in the French parliament immediately for that, in the Bundestag and everywhere in Europe. They are far away from the markets. They have an enormous difficulty to understand that the market today are made of those who are long and those who are short. That they could not understand that it was a big mistake. And of course, seen from a political standpoint, you say, I don't want to put my public money without a big contribution of private money and so forth. And they had an enormous difficulty to understand that. We have to accept that things are, from time to time, very, very complex. But we hold. And if you want a benchmark, ask or refer to what New York was thinking of us at the moment of the explosion of the crisis, of their crisis, and then at the moment of the explosion of our European crisis. And look at what happened. I can tell you, because I was permanently discussing with them, they were convinced that it would explode. Absolutely convinced. And as I said, some, very fortunately, and there is a justice, lost some money on these bets. Anyway, thank you very, very much indeed.